Hi everyone. In today's video, I'm going to show you how to write a Java singleton. A singleton is a design pattern that allows you to have a single instance of your object reference in case you need something like a database connection or a logger or something like that. If you've had the pleasure of playing around with different types of singletons, you might be familiar with those that are eager versus lazy initialized, or those that are used for single-threaded versus multi-threaded environments. In today's video, I'm gonna go through a wide range of singletons, and we're gonna talk about the pros and cons of their different implementations. Let's dive right into it. All right, now that we have IntelliJ up, the first singleton that we're gonna go through today is the Enum Singleton. It's called the Enum Singleton because we are going to use enums. So instead of a class, we're gonna call this an enum. And we're going to create a single instance of our enum right here. And this is a singleton you want to use 90% of the time or more in most situations. This singleton is thread safe. It is really easy to understand. And it's not going to have really any room for bugs because there are guarantees in the language that talk about how enums work and how enum instances work specifically. This singleton approach is used within the JDK and within a lot of other common libraries. So if you're writing a singleton, this should be your first choice as far as how you implement it. The only real downside to this type of singleton is the initialization type. So I mentioned earlier that there is eager and lazy initialization. The difference is with eager initialization, you initialize it right away. With lazy, you don't initialize it until you know you really need it. So in a lot of situations, eager is just fine because you know that you need the instance later on. But in certain situations where you need to wait until you actually know that you need to establish a connection to a database, or maybe that connection takes a lot of time or it's difficult to maintain, then you might want to do lazy. All right, now on to singleton number two. So public class instead of an enum this time, let's make it public. Public static final singleton instance equals new singleton. So this looks similar to the enum singleton, but it has some major differences. This is not a safe singleton. Do not do this. The main reason is you could very easily just create a new instance of this singleton. And that's because when there's no constructor supplied, the compiler generates an automatic public no op constructor for you. So this code is equivalent to this code. So effectively, you can create as many singleton instances as you want to, and that entirely breaks the point of the design pattern. But what if we get a little more fancy and we convert this into a private constructor? Well, this helps. Now we have a situation where the typical user would not be able to create an instance of our class, and you can just call singleton.instance. This is getting better, but it still has two potential flaws. So the first one is if you make a static nested class, so let's say private static class singleton helper. What you can do in here, if you really wanted to, is you could say singleton S equals new singleton. And lo and behold, even though it's a private constructor, we can still call it in a different class, albeit from a nested class. So this is really only an issue if someone has access to the source code. Okay, you could argue if they don't have source code access, then this really is invalid, right? Okay, sure. So let's say that we can't do that. But there still is a different problem here, and that is reflection. There's no code in here that is currently preventing me from asking the singleton class for all of its declared constructors, marking a constructor as visible and being able to invoke it, even though it is marked private here. So in theory, I could invoke this constructor and I could generate my own instance, and I could again break the concept of a singleton. Yeah, so not good. If I want to be safe against reflection, I have a few options. I can either prevent my class from being accessed via reflection entirely, which is a whole other topic, or what I could do is I could throw an exception here within the constructor. So I could say throw new illegal state exception, and then we can say private constructor. And then since this is an unchecked exception, we don't have to declare any throws clauses or anything, and this covers the intent better. So this singleton does a pretty good job too. It creates a single instance via static fields, which have a guarantee that you have a single thread that is doing the static initialization. And then you prevent reflection via having an unchecked exception getting thrown within a private constructor. So again, though, would you really choose this implementation or would you just use the enum singleton? I would probably stick with the enum singleton rather than this one because there's more code, and with more code could come more bugs, but it could be a bit of a personal preference thing. Another alternative to this singleton that you might see in code is using static initializers specifically, and that would be doing something like this. And then here, you would now say something like that. So the previous code and this code are the same currently. The only difference is if singleton, this constructor, ended up being more complicated and it actually could throw an exception, then you could do a try catch within the static block here. The problem is if the instance isn't constructed correctly, your instance design pattern can fall apart a little bit. So that's something to also be wary about. So far we've talked about eager initialization. Let's talk about lazy initialization for a second. So let's say that in the start here, we don't want to instantiate our instance right away. We want to do it lazily. So that changes our approach quite a bit. So the first thing we want to do is within our private constructor check, we can say if instance doesn't equal null, then we want to throw this illegal state exception. And I'll just leave it as private constructor. We could change that string if we really wanted to. If, however, I do create this instance via reflection, I'll just roll with that. I'll go ahead and create it. But now what I'm going to add is a public static method that is a getter for the instance. So it can either be a get or a get instance. Typically, it is get instance, and you can see IntelliJ even has a shortcut for it because of how often it's used. So in this case, the IDE generated method needs a little work because this is lazy initialized. So what we want to say is if instance is null, then we can do instance equals new singleton. And I need to update this to have it not be final. So basically what happens here is the instance will not be initialized until getInstance gets called the first time. So this can be really useful if it takes a while to construct the instance, but what it also means is that the first person who gets the instance has to wait until the creation happens. So trade-offs. Bottom line, when you're making a singleton, one of the important questions you need to ask yourself is this a lazy or an eager singleton? If your singleton is a lazy singleton, then you have to ask yourself another question. Is this singleton intended for single-threaded or multi-threaded use? Really, you should assume multi-threaded use unless you explicitly are told single-threaded use is okay. So let's take a look at our lazy singleton and make it thread safe now. The problem with the existing implementation is if I have two threads that get into the getInstance method at the same time, the first thread might start calling the singleton constructor while the second thread is determining if instance is null, and you might call the singleton constructor twice. So one way that people solve this is they make sure that the getInstance method is synchronized. And another thing that we really should do is, since we're talking about mutable data members talking across multiple threads, is we should mark this singleton instance as volatile. So this is one way that you could fix it. Whenever you enter the getInstance method, you're always using synchronization protection. And volatile ensures that when we've done a write on the instance variable here, that any other threads that do reads after that write has been done see the new value from the write, rather than looking at like an old value or something like that. The complaint often heard with this multi-threaded singleton is that it's not as efficient as it could be. And that is because the getInstance method is synchronized even after the instance has been initialized. So when that happens, we have all this extra synchronization overhead when we don't need it anymore. It's relatively trivial for most applications, but if your application is very performance critical and you need to optimize this get instance method, there is a way you can do that via a doubly checked singleton. So what I can do is I can copy that if check, and then I need to do this null check twice. So the first time I get to do it when, let's say that the instance has not been initialized yet. So we're entering this if statement. Now we need to have a synchronized block over singleton.class. So now only one thread can enter this area of code. And then now we do the same thing we did earlier right here. And then we need to remove the synchronized out of the method. This looks a little funky, doesn't it? So basically, now when instance is initialized, now you do not need the overhead of synchronized anymore. When instance is not yet initialized, you have to do two null checks, but you do ensure that you do have synchronization. So it takes a touch longer the first time that you have to make your instance, but in the grand scheme of things, it's pretty negligible. You might be wondering why we have to do the null check twice. Well, let's talk through that. Let's say that we have thread A and B that enter the getInstance method at essentially the same time. Instance is going to be null for both of them. So then now thread A gets the lock and goes into the synchronized block, and thread B is waiting to enter the synchronized block. So instance is still null, so we initialize it by calling the constructor, and then we get the object reference. Thread A exits the synchronized block, and then thread B enters the synchronized block. When thread B has entered the synchronized block, instance is no longer null, so you skip over this and you only call the constructor once. A very, very important thing is that this does not work if the field that you are editing is not volatile. So we have to declare this as volatile. This is very important because if you happen to be using something that is older than JDK 5, then this will not work properly. You will get some strange behavior where every once in a while you might still have two calls to the constructor happening. Sometimes this is even present in the bytecode. And take a look at the instructions that the JVM is getting. Every once in a while with pre-JDK 5, you could see bugs where this code did not work properly. You have to mark your field as volatile, and you have to use the new volatile semantics that came with JDK 5 and later. So what I'm trying to say is, that last method comes with a lot of caveats. Some people, it's like their favorite thing ever, and they have to use lazy singletons, and they have to do the doubly checked and then locking. If you ask me, yeah, it works, but there is a better way to do it that still offers lazy initialization. Let's look at that next. And this time, we're going to make a static nested class. We're just gonna call it singleton holder. And then within the singleton holder class, what we want to do is we want to create an instance of our singleton within our static nested class. So we'll call this our instance equals new singleton, which again, we showed static nested classes have access to even private constructors. So that's why this works. And we're going to go ahead and mark it final. And then now we no longer need instance up here. And then down here, all we need to do is we just get to return singleton holder.instance. And voila, a lot easier, right? Well, there is still one caveat, and that is within the singleton constructor here, there aren't super straightforward ways to verify that we aren't calling another instance. So technically, we are still prone to reflection issues here. So I hope this sheds some light on the differences between an eager and a lazy singleton. And especially with lazy singletons, it gets a lot more complicated as far as how you write a singleton that is not error prone. Aren't singletons fun? Nah, I think so. It kind of depends on the use cases. Some people say that singletons are the worst thing ever and are even anti-pattern. I think that they can be an anti-pattern if they're used incorrectly, but if you're using a singleton for its intended purpose, it does have a place. And I'll stress again that to avoid a lot of issues with singletons, you really want to use enum singletons unless you have a specific need where an enum singleton's not good enough for you. In my time writing Java code, I've only come across a couple instances where I couldn't use an enum singleton, and I really had to think about why I couldn't. So, what do you think? Which singleton do you think is the best? Have you had situations where you couldn't use an enum singleton and you had to come up with your own singleton approach? Let me know in the comments below. I hope you enjoyed today's video. If you did, I'd really appreciate you smashing that like button. Thank you for watching. I hope you have a good rest of your day, and I hope to see you next time. Take care.